This interview is with Dr. Duncan Forgan, a St. Andrews astrophysicist. We talk about his extensive work with SETI, the search for extraterrestrial intelligence, how he would host his perfect dinner party, and how he takes his morning coffee. Enjoy listening! You're listening to Insight, the University of St. Andrews Student Physics Society's podcast. I'm your host, Samuel Avery. Join us as we journey into the lives of St. Andrews academics, discovering their passions, inspirations, and motivations. So today on Insight, we're interviewing Dr. Duncan Forgan, an astrophysicist here at St. Andrews. So welcome to Insight.
Hi, it's nice to be here.
Could you tell us a bit about your positions here, please?
So in 2014, I came to St. Andrews as a postdoctoral fellow, and I've been in that role for a few years, and just recently I've become an associate lecturer.
Congratulations. Could you tell us a bit about your research that you're doing here?
Okay, so during my PhD, I studied planet formation, which is how you produce planets around stars. I was very interested in one of the less favored models of planet formation. So the kind of current favored model is that you take small dust grains that arrive in the disk that forms around a star when it's born. Those dust grains hit each other and become slightly bigger. They coalesce. You keep doing this enough times, you start to make bigger and bigger things, and eventually you start to make pebbles, boulders, asteroids. Those asteroids start to smash together and form big things, things that are maybe the size of the moon. And as time goes on, those things hit each other, and then you form bigger and bigger objects. And then you can basically grow a gas giant from that. You've got a big core of solid material that collects gas from the disk, and that's your gas giant. And the unlucky ones don't get to collect the gas because the gas is gone. They become terrestrial planets. And that's kind of the standard view of planet formation. My work was focused on an opposite view, which is looking at the disk when it's very young and it's very massive compared to the star. So the gravity of the disk is really important. And we were looking at the possibility of the disk becoming unstable to its own gravity and breaking up into pieces, and those pieces are effectively planets. And so one very active area of research we're looking at just now is what kind of planets do you make, if that's the way you make planets. And it's very clear that we don't make all the planets we see. So the extrasolar planets we see, most of them are probably made by the standard model, if you like. But our model might be good at explaining the odd ones, and that's kind of the thing that we're pushing, is to figure out, okay, can we make the oddball systems by this different technique? As a sideline, while I was doing my PhD, I got very interested in SETI and looking for intelligent life, and that has been a very big part of my career. Even while studying on what we might consider to be a mainstream piece of astrophysics, I've also been looking at something a bit weird at the same time. And it's taken me to some very weird places, and to some weird bits of outreach that I've done, and to some very fun trips.
And SETI's just the search for extraterrestrial
intelligence. Sorry, yes. So SETI is the search for extraterrestrial intelligence. And so SETI, as an acronym, refers to all sorts of things. So there's the SETI Institute that's based at Mountain View in California. But there are also lots of other groups who are involved in that as well. So there's a group at Berkeley who I collaborate very closely with, and there are groups at, well, there was a group at Harvard, I think they're still kicking around, and there are groups all over the UK as well, and we have this UK SETI research network which I helped to found. So SETI is a discipline, there's the SETI Institute, and there's lots of other places doing it as well, and we all have very different approaches for finding intelligent life, and it's become a really interesting point in time for SETI, because we now know about planets around other stars. We didn't know that until, you know, about 20 years ago. So we can now look for intelligent life in places where we think there's a better chance of there being intelligent life. We can say, okay, that star has these planets going around it. Those planets have the potential for hosting liquid water on the surface. That's maybe a key thing for making life. We should think about looking at those systems and see if we can see transmissions from there.
Okay.
So that's something that's kind of only happened in the last 10 years. So it's really new stuff. And we can now say things about the local universe that we couldn't say 10 years ago, in terms of, okay, here's a system that we think could have had life. We don't see any signs of intelligent life. We don't see the traditional signs that we're not seeing, you know, powerful radio signals or laser beams in the optical or any of the things that we consider as being useful ways of sending messages from here to another star. So that tells us something. Doesn't tell us lots of things. You know, it tells us that they're not transmitting in our direction right now, or, you know, if the planet is 50 light years away, they're not transmitting in our direction 50 years ago. That's not a lot of information, but it's way more than we used to have, which is a big start.
Okay. So your research is predominantly planet formation, and that has gone on to inform your work with SETI and where you, in the search for extraterrestrial intelligence, people want to look, essentially. Yes.
That's a good way of describing it, because we want to think about intelligent life as being a process that actually begins, well, really at the very beginning of the universe.
Well,
right?
I think we'll come back to SETI in a minute.
Yeah.
But we'll ask a few more questions about your research. So
sure.
You work predominantly with simulations, yes? So what are the benefits of working with simulations, and what do you find interesting about that?
One of the main benefits is that simulations are not messy, right? I mean, you don't have to go into the lab and kind of muck things up. So from a personal point of view, they're in some ways quite straightforward to manage, right? You have a supercomputer that you submit your simulation to, it runs, you analyze the data. You are in control of the whole situation from beginning to end. Like, you design the simulation runs, you design how the data comes out. So when you analyze the data, if the data is poor, it's your fault, right? So you can say, well, okay, maybe next time I'll run it, but I'll produce the data in a different way so that I can analyze it more easily. So you can design things very specifically. You don't have to worry about the actual laws of physics. You can worry about the laws of physics that you put into the program. So if you're only interested in how, say, gravity and radiation physics affects your problem, you can put those things in, and you can ignore chemistry, you can ignore magnetic fields, you can ignore all the horrible stuff that happens in the universe that we don't fully understand yet, and you can say, right, okay, how does it work when I know that only these things are acting? Or you can go even further still and say, right, I'll run it with this bit of physics in, and then I'll run it again with this bit of physics switched off. And that tells you lots of things. You can learn lots by running things that don't look anything like the universe, but you can use physics to say, ah, I understand how these physical processes work when I switch them on and off. That lets me learn something about the universe at large.
So it's really the high level of control.
Yes.
And it sounds a little bit like it fulfills a God complex, maybe, for astrophysicists.
I think there's a little bit of that. I mean, the problem with astrophysics is that there's very little of it you can do in the lab, right? You can do the planet bit. You can go and look at the Earth and say, right, well, how did the Earth form? Which is basically geophysics to some level, right? You can go and actually look at rocks, and you can go and look at the oceans. You can go and look at the atmosphere, and you can take samples, and you can measure, and you can look at how the Earth has changed with time. You can't really do much else. I mean, you can go to the moon, for example, and you can look at how moons form. But it's quite hard taking a sample from the sun. You can't have a little sun running in the lab, right? I know that people are trying to do this with nuclear fusion and things like that, and that's really interesting. But the laboratory astrophysics you can do is very limited, right? Because you just can't put a planet in the lab, right? It's too big. You can't put a star in the lab because it'll destroy the lab. And that's, you know, a fairly tame thing compared to some of the things that are out there in the universe, right? So a lot of the experiments we have to do are in the computer. We have no choice.
Do you ever wish that you could do more labs? I mean, it sounds like you're not a fan.
I have to say that I was never the best at labs as a student. I was much better at programming. It would be nice to have some things we can do in the lab. There's been a bit of a renaissance in exoplanet science in the lab. I have a few colleagues, some of whom who used to work here actually, who are now doing bits of lab experiments that on the face of it have nothing to do with exoplanets, but tell you important things about things like prebiotic chemistry and the origin of life and things like that, and the role of how the sun has changed with time, how the Earth's atmosphere has changed with time. You know, the early Earth looked very different to the Earth we see today. You know, the atmospheric composition was very different. So when you're talking about origin of life experiments, you have to know what that atmosphere is. Knowing that is very hard. But with the best information we have, we can then say, right, okay, let's put the sun as it was billions of years ago with an atmospheric composition that looks like the Earth billions of years ago, at least to the best of our knowledge. And then let's try and see if the key reactions that form, you know, the basic amino acids, and then maybe proteins if you're really, really super lucky. You know, these first basic steps towards towards life as we know it.
Okay.
So there are attempts to do these experiments now, which, you know, they have a long history. They go all the way back to the 50s. But we now know so much more about the Earth. We know so much more about other planets that we have a much better handle on how we think life formed here, even though we still don't really know. We know what we don't know, and we know what's definitely not the case. So we're kind of ticking things off and ruling things out and kind of drawing a box around the answer in a way we couldn't do in the past. So that's really exciting. So there are some lab things you can do, but when you're trying to build planets, you can't build a planet in the lab. You can do the initial bits. You can fire interstellar grains against each other in zero gravity, and people do that to check how grains will attach to each other. But when you get to the final stage of like smashing together moons to form things that are the size of Mars, you can't do that, right? You
know, I imagine there's also ethical issues with smashing together moons.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
Planets that may or may not have life.
That's right. yeah, so that there's bigger questions now. As you get better at doing things, you know, are you justified in carrying out these experiments? And the risks involved become really large. So simulations are great because, you know, a simulation can't complain at this point, unless it's somehow sentient, which we can't do yet. You know, that's a problem
probably,
for AI.
Probably don't want to do necessarily.
No, then you've got an ethical problem. Right now, the simulations we run are, you know, extremely simple in that sense. But they're, you know, a simple set of instructions to say, here's some gas, here are the laws of physics that we want to put in, what happens next? That's enough to make it really complicated and difficult to analyze. So we're happy just to work with that for now.
Okay. So what timescale do researchers in your field work on for problems? Is it weeks, months, years?
It depends. So the calculations that I do kind of vary. So there can be the most complicated calculations that we run, and we're actually running those on a supercomputer in Cambridge, and we have to run it there because they're the only people that can run it, basically. We had to apply for time in the same way that an astronomer who's using telescopes, they apply for time and they get time and they can look at the targets they're interested in. We applied for time on the supercomputer because it was the only one that could do it. It's now running it. It's a massive calculation. It's taking months to run. It will take months to analyze. It will probably take several years from pressing play on the simulation to having something published. You have that. And then at the other end of the scale, you can run what you can call a semi-analytic calculation. So the equations are very simple. It's not a full simulation, but you can't write down a solution. You have to do a numerical calculation to get the solutions out. And those can be set up and run, and they can produce data in, you know, a couple of hours. And you can analyze them in a couple of weeks. So it depends on your problem. It can either be years, or it can be weeks, or it can be something in between. If you have large numbers of collaborators, then it can take even longer, because sometimes you're running several different pieces of code and then trying to smoosh the data together to make sense. Or you're, you know, running the code, taking the output, giving it to somebody else to run on their code, taking it back.
So really, it's a whole range of timescales, and it depends on how many factors are involved.
Oh yeah, so it depends on, you know, how many people are working on the problem, how many people have different projects that are taking up their time, and it's a case of time management.
And what hardware you have access to.
What hardware you've got, and, you know, more sort of human concerns like, when am I going to run out of money, and, you know, where am I working in 6 months, which are things that researchers have to keep thinking about, because until you get a permanent position, your contracts are generally only a few years long. So you're trying to run projects that last a few years and then at the same time try and apply for money or try and apply for another position in the middle of all that. So it's a big juggle, and time management is really important. It's a big skill to learn. And if you can't manage your time, then you just can't do research.
I feel extra bad about being late for the interview now. So to come back to SETI, what was it that made you first interested in looking for evidence of extraterrestrials? I should probably ask, do you believe?
So this is a big question, right? I would be very surprised if we're the only form of intelligent life in the universe. I'd be very surprised if we're the only form of intelligent life in the Milky Way galaxy. I would not be surprised if we never saw them. I think it's quite possible that, you know, in a galaxy with 100 billion stars, there might only be 10, you know, different planets that have intelligent species on them. And if you take those 10 planets and put them at different parts of the Milky Way, they can live their entire lives and not be aware of each other, you know. So as far as I'm concerned, the odds of it are really, really low that we'll ever see a signal or they'll see us.
But you still got interested in looking anyway.
Oh, yeah, right. I mean, you know, there's an important thing to remember, which is that when you're doing any kind of scientific experiment, you start with your theory, which might be informed by things that have been done in the past. It might be informed by previous experiments. It's also partially informed by your own opinions. Dangerously, it can be formed by your own prejudices as well. So you've got to take all that into account when you come up with your initial sort of opinions or theories about what might be happening in the universe. But then you go and do the experiment, right? You can't just sit there in your armchair and say, well, based on my understanding of the universe, there can't be any other forms of intelligent life, or that they're just too far away, we'll never see them. You've got to go and check, right? You've got to go and confirm your theory with observations and experiments and tests. So even if you expect a negative result, you've got to go and check it's a negative result. It's less sexy, it's boring, it's terrifying in some level, because, you know, we do the search and we find nothing. That kind of proves that actually all the things we used to think about from, you know, Copernicus up to the present day, that we've kind of taken humans from the center of the universe to something that's orbiting the center of the universe to something that's not even the center of the universe anymore. You know, the sun is, you know, a part of a massive collection of stars called a galaxy, and that galaxy is not the center of the universe. We've spent all the sort of last 500 years taking humans away from this unique position and making them less and less special. And then we could end up turning it all around at the end and saying, well, okay, you know, there's not a huge amount that's special about the sun, maybe even about the solar system, but the fact that humans are here is actually pretty special, because there's only, you know, a handful of planets in the Milky Way that have intelligent life. So we could turn things on its head and say, actually, that rule of thumb we've used for all this time is now wrong. And humans are pretty special and unique, and we need to think more carefully about how we act.
So that's a very exciting conclusion to come to.
Yeah. So whatever you find out, you either find out that there's other forms of intelligent life, which is brilliant, or you find out that humans are really rare gems, which is also brilliant, right? Because that kind of confirms something that we kind of think about ourselves deep inside, that actually humans are pretty cool. And yeah, it might well be that we are so unique and so rare that, okay, one, we can pat ourselves on the back to some degree, having got this far. We've got to places that very few atoms in the universe have got to. But two, we need to think more carefully about how we act as a species, because we might be the rarest example of some, you know, arrangement of matter in the universe, and that what we do kind of represents the universe in a lot of ways. That we're, I can't remember who was it said it, but, you know, the universe's way of thinking about itself. That's a big responsibility. You know, we need to look after ourselves, the planet, all the planets that we see, potentially the local, you know, solar neighborhood could be ours, right? That we have to go and look after and protect. So if we find out this information by looking and seeing no signs of intelligent life, that completely rewrites the way that we think about ourselves and our relationship to the universe. So there's, of course, you've got to do this.
Very profound. So what do you personally hope SETI will achieve within your lifetime then?
Well, I think...
Is there any way to rule out different planets having life?
There is a lot of things you can do to rule out, right? And there will always be wiggle room at the end to say, well, we didn't search in this way, and if we'd searched in that way, maybe we would have found something. There are certainly things we can do right now to check if there are anyone transmitting, you know, a radio signal to us. And we can check for quite a long distance, in fact. You know, so within a few hundred light years of the Earth, we can check if anybody's transmitting a strong signal in our direction. And there are teams doing that. So the team that I'm working with in Berkeley, the Breakthrough Listen team, are carrying out this survey right now with a series of telescopes. So they've got telescopes in the United States, telescopes in Australia, and they will soon be looking, I think, with telescopes in South Africa as well. So they've got a big collaboration They're searching, I think they'll search a million stars by the end. They'll know of those stars, are any of them sending signals to us, you know, during this point in time. And you'll be able to say, right, okay, we can confirm that there are no transmitters with a power equal to, you know, some kind of thing that we can identify. The usual things we look at are airport radar, or interstellar radar. So we send radar pulses to check where things are. For example, our spacecraft, we can send a pulse. We can see that pulse come back to us and we can say, right, the spacecraft is there. So we can say, okay, there are no interstellar radar broadcasters, you know, within this distance of the Earth. And that's an important first step because you're ruling out the simplest, easiest way to transmit information from one planet to the other, energetically the cheapest, right? So you'd assume that, you know, if aliens have economics or thermodynamics, right? So this is the basic fundamental laws of physics here. If they follow those laws and say, right, we want to speak to people on other planets or on other stars, we don't want to spend too much money or too much energy, here's the way you do it, you use the radio. We can rule that out and say that's not happening in the local universe. The next step, of course, is to consider whether they do something that's more expensive, right? Maybe they actually don't transmit radio photons, they transmit optical photons. And the Breakthrough Listen team are looking for optical photons too in a separate survey. Then your next step is, well, maybe they do something weird, right? Maybe they send neutrinos to each other. So neutrinos are going to pass through most interstellar things with as if it's not there. You know, there's 6 billion solar neutrinos passing through your thumb every second or something like that. So these are great things for sending across long distances when there's stuff in the way. You can send them. They're not going to get scattered. They're not going to get, you know, absorbed by anything except the detector at the other side. Great. Maybe we should search for neutrinos. And there are people doing neutrino astronomy. And they'll be able to say, okay, there are no strong neutrino sources within a certain distance of the Earth. So we're slowly ticking off all these things. But there will always be something that we can't do yet, right? The next thing would be, okay, are aliens sending gravitational waves to us? You know, and then you can always say, well, okay, well, we can now detect gravitational waves of a certain strength using LIGO. We can go and search to see if there are strong gravitational wave pulses in the universe. So far, there's no sign of, you know, artificial gravitational waves. We know the sources. We know that they're natural phenomena. So yeah, we can take this step, which will happen in a sort of 15 to 20 year time frame. So, you know, in the near future, we'll be able to say, right, there's nothing really within the local neighborhood. Like, so 100 light years, maybe even 1,000 if we're doing well, you know, that region is empty, it's quiet. And so we can say, okay, if we assume that civilizations are uniformly plotted in the Milky Way, we know roughly the number density of civilizations. There's 1 per 1,000 light years cubed. That's a fundamental limit, right? There we go. We've got a first step to saying, at this point in time, there are this many civilizations per cubic light year in the universe.
Okay, so you can continually rule out different methods of communication. Do you think there's a danger of kind of humanity's ego building momentum saying, yeah, we've not heard from anyone this way, we've not heard from anyone this way, maybe we are the only people? Because, you know, do you think there's a danger that we grow this ego and then we get to a point where someone turns around and says, yeah, I'm here too, and then we have to reevaluate everything and we need to say, well, maybe this is a threat because we were the only ones?
Well, yeah, I mean, this is always going to be an issue. And one of the things that I've worked with quite strongly, and I'm continuing to work with colleagues, is what do you do if you find something, right? You know, I am a pessimist. I don't think we'll find something, but you need to be aware of the possibility of what happens if you do find something, because it's so important to how we think of ourselves and how that will impact culture, you know, the society at large, how it will affect politics, religion. So there's a number of us now. I'm a member of the International Academy of Astronautics Permanent Committee on SETI. It's the closest thing SETI has to a governing body. And this committee has on its books a set of protocols for what you do if you find something, they're out of date. They were written in 1989. They were partially revised in 2010. But what they have in there at the moment is guidelines for how to act in a world before social media, before you know, smartphones, before the way that we communicate ideas and how we debate now. And you know, it's easy to look at how we communicate ideas about things close to home and realize we're not very good at certain things, or that people can manipulate the debate in certain ways. So when you've got a story as groundbreaking as "We are not alone in the universe," you need to handle it carefully. And we're thinking now about how to essentially redraft these protocols to make them relevant for the modern era. And it's something I'm very excited about, because I think it's going to be something of great importance if something is found. I think even if we don't find anything, this conversation you have about, right, what do you do in the event, will kind of inform that kind of question you said there of, okay, maybe we'll not find anything in the next 100 years, but maybe in 1,000 years, you know, if humanity survives that long and we get far enough out into the Milky Way, or we can search far enough into the universe, maybe the next galaxy over has somebody like us, and we can have a conversation that's limited, you know. Maybe they're far enough away that it takes thousands of years for, you know, a signal to come to us and back to them. We still have to have this kind of conversation with ourselves about what it means to be intelligent, what it means to be human, and all those things you said about ego and the emotional component of an intelligent being. We need to have those discussions kind of earlier rather than later, because if we don't, then we could make some very poor decisions.
Okay, so it's something that people have been talking about for 30-odd years, mm-hmm. but we're looking at future-proofing and revising again.
Yeah, so we're talking about the near future, but I think there is a component that remains of saying, well, you know, okay, we redraft it now, but in 15, 20 years' time, the way that we do this will change again, and we'll have to do it again, you know? And our knowledge of the universe will have changed by then. The ways that we'll extract information from astrophysical data will change. You know, we've gone from, you know, several hundred years ago saying that we'll never know the chemical composition of a star, and this was learned scientists saying this, to people saying, well, okay, we'll be able to know that planets orbit other stars, but we'll know nothing about their chemical composition. And that's also wrong, because we now know that there are many planets out there that have CO2, methane, water, you know, all the things that we think about as being relevant to biology. Okay, they're in the atmospheres of giant planets, you know, orbiting very close to their stars and are very hot. So maybe they're not necessarily good sites for life. But as we get these techniques nailed down and we improve them, we're going to start applying them to planets that look more like ours. So we're attacking the problem from all different angles, not just for intelligent life, but life of any kind. We need to have these conversations soon, because one thing that is very common is people seeing something and then going, I found something, I think it's intelligent life. The entire community says, no, it's not, it's a bug in your machine, or you've just, you know, had a signal ping off a satellite and come in your telescope, you know, calm the beans. We need to deal with those kind of problems. And, you know, some of the work that I've done recently is how to communicate to the public about what it is people have found and how excited we think you should be. You know, okay, this signal looks amazing, but the probability of it being an actual alien signal is tiny, so just, you know, cool your jets. Or this signal looks kind of dull, but we have a high belief that it's actually from something, you know, that could be intelligent. These kind of scenarios we can now describe to the public in a better way. We've got tools for it. So it's really important to do it. We've got to make sure that when we talk to the public about this stuff, that we're honest, that we're transparent, and that there's no room for people to accuse us of, you know, government conspiracies or anything like that, because the community is rife with these kinds of, I mean, what's the word? Crackpot speculation that, you know, aliens have been here and that they've abducted us and that they've carried out experiments on humans and blah, blah, blah. You know, scientific trash, right? This is pseudoscientific nonsense. But it dogs the field, it brings us all down, it makes us all look like idiots. So we have to deal with it in a really important, dignified, respectful way to make sure that the public understands, yes, mm-hmm. there are people out there who claim these things, and they're wrong. But there are also a group of scientists who are taking the problem seriously, doing it with academic rigor and really trying hard with a pessimistic hat on to try and prove or disprove the existence of intelligent life.
So this has been a conversation that's evolving between scientists and the public. Mm-hmm. What would you say is the biggest misconception about SETI then?
That it's full of weirdos. I mean, academia is full of weirdos to some degree, right? You know, it's a pretty rarefied environment. You get people who, in many respects, would probably not survive in the modern world unless they had the safety of academia to live in. But there is this assumption that SETI scientists are UFO hunters, right? And nothing could be further from the truth, right? I haven't met a professional, quote-unquote, ufologist in all my time studying it. I've read books by them, but, you know, you can get 10 or 15 pages in and realize that they're claptrap, right? They're applying very unscientific thinking and poor ration to what's actually going on. I think that's the biggest misconception, is that we're all nutcases. Yeah, there are a couple of nutcases, but they are the fringe, right? There is a group of people who are interested in doing the experiment properly and being absolutely certain and giving the field scientific credibility. And I think it's in the last 10 years, there's been a real change that SETI was seen as fringe science when I started. But with the latest set of experiments coming in and the rigor being applied, I think there's been a definite change in tone. So papers on SETI are being published in journals that would never have countenanced them in the past. You know, so the Astrophysical Journal, which is kind of one of the top journals in astronomy, is now accepting SETI papers that I'm sure would have been rejected if I'd been submitting that kind of paper 10 years ago. And there are journals now, you know, of high quality and respect publishing this stuff. There's been a real sea change.
So people are really recognising it as a scientific discipline.
Yeah.
Okay. Quick question. You mentioned that you're on this analogy to a governing body for SETI. Mm-hmm. So if the aliens make contact and say, take me to your leader, how high up that list are you then?
Not very high. So
you think you get superseded by the President of the United States?
So in the current draft of the protocol, the person who would speak for Earth is the Secretary General of the United Nations. And to some degree, the chair of the UN Committee on the Peaceful Uses of Outer Space. So the UN COPUS, as the acronym goes, their role has been, in the past, has been to deal with things like nuclear testing and the militarization of outer space. But obviously one of the offshoots of all this was this thinking that, you know, back in the 60s, it was seemed quite possible that, you know, we just started searching in the radio. Maybe the universe is crowded and full of alien life and that we just haven't been searching. And that if we turned a radio telescope to the right star, we would get, you know, endless amounts of TV broadcasts and it would just, you know, it would happen in a couple of years. If you look at the early papers in the 60s, there was that feeling of real optimism that it wouldn't take long, you know. Okay, you know, humans are here and we were probably quite common or garden as a species. There's probably billions of Earth-like planets out there. We've just got to, you know, train the telescopes for 10, 20 years and the hits will start coming in. So at that time, a lot of ideas were going to place about, you know, the United Nations role in all this. So that's where a lot of these ideas got filtered in. So in terms of my role in a post-detection world, as somebody who helps to write post-detection policy, I suspect that the Scottish government would want to speak to me quite a bit. It's quite possible that the UK government at Westminster would want my input as a consultant. After that, I'm not entirely sure how it would go because, you know, you write down these rules and say, right, if this happens, we'll do this, and if this happens, we'll do that, and the next thing, and the next thing. And if you look at history and how people act before something happens and how they act when the thing happens are very different things. And national security is a big thing. Protecting the national interest is obviously the most important component of any government's role. So they will act in ways that we would consider potentially unpleasant or immoral, but they have different rules to what we have as scientists, right? You know, the Permanent Committee is for the most part, global. It's not entirely representative. I think we could do with more representation from Africa and from the East. There's very little Chinese representation, for example, on the committee. But it's well representative of the United States, Europe, and the UK, and to some degree Russia. But yeah, I think there's a definite element that if this thing was found, then, you know, we would do our best to keep it public and to have as much information out in the public domain as possible, because that's kind of been our policy, you know, all this time. But the amount of it that would end up in the public domain would end up being a function of the government's activities. One thing that I have looked at going back to history, it's funny, like I did a lot of physics as a school kid, and I dropped a lot of social science quite early on to get to physics. And going back, you know, I think I wish I'd done more history at school. But one thing that I always go back to is how governments acted before the First World War. And in the run-up to the First World War, it became very clear that if there was a conflict, the idea of using gas was a big thing. And there were several conferences discussing, well, what should we do? This thing is potentially exceptionally dangerous. Is it okay to use gas in war? That was the kind of the question they were asking. And a lot of governments signed a treaty saying, we're not going to use gas in war. And the signatories to that treaty included basically all the parties that did end up using gas in the First World War. So there's the good, high-minded notions that you have before something happens, and then the moment where everything changes and the threat is real. And, you know, there's the government signing one thing, and then there are the generals ordering the use of gas in war. And they may do it knowingly that they're committing a crime. They may do it under the idea that they're not committing a crime and they're in fact protecting national interests and security. And I think we can all agree the use of gas was horrific. So you can see how, you know, and that's a pretty gory and horrible example, but it kind of underlines the point of how people behave before something happens and how they behave once a thing has happened. So frankly, I don't know, right? We're putting down policy and best practice. We can only hope that it gets abided by, and that the government includes us in the process rather than excludes us. But we really don't know. We don't know what the government's policy is, because they may well not have one. Or if they do have one, it's super top secret. Who knows?
Okay, so it's really something that you just need to wait and see.
Yeah.
But it is something that has been thought about on kind of all levels.
Definitely. Yeah, I mean, we're certainly thinking about it. The UN is keen to hear our thoughts on it. The British government listens to us, whether they write down anything we say. Who knows?
Okay. Well, that's been absolutely fascinating to hear about SETI and your work with that. Could you tell us a bit more about yourself? So what do you miss about being a student?
Lions. Getting to lie in. You know, so I have a young daughter, and she gets up invariably at 6:30 or 7:00. So being able to lie in until 10:00 in the morning used to be great. Obviously, as a student, you don't get to do that often. When I was a student in Edinburgh, and second year physics was a 9:00 lecture, and I was about 30 minutes walk from the uni, so you couldn't, you know, be too late in bed. But the idea of being able to sleep through the night and get up later than 7:00 and all that, and the general freedom. It's a cliche to say that, you know, the student life is the best times of your life. It kind of is. I would say that for me, the best times of my life were probably as a postgrad, because not only could you lie in because you didn't have lectures, you were getting paid, and you were doing research. It was really exciting. It was really engaging. And you could go to the pub whenever you wanted, pretty much, you know. If you're having a tough day and you need to leave early, you could do that, as long as you were getting the work done. You do miss a lot about it, and the excitement of learning about the universe. And there are certain moments that always stick with you. For me, it was learning how Maxwell's equations produce light as an electromagnetic wave. I think it was my second or third year electromagnetism course, we kind of went through, you know, the derivation and how we saw that happening and how that all emerged. And I can remember all of us sitting having a coffee afterwards and going, wow, you know, I've been blown away and having like the closest thing I've ever had to a spiritual experience about physics, right? Which seems weird and kind of nerdy, but it's true. You know, like that was astonishing. And then I think in my final year, we did Hamiltonian dynamics and we learned about Noether's theorem, which is how conservation laws relate to symmetries of the universe. And that, I think, is probably one of my favorite moments as an undergrad, is learning that particular theorem and seeing how, you know, time symmetry gives you energy conservation. I still can't get my head around that today, you know, and I've been doing physics for years since. Those moments of the learning really fundamental, important things about the universe and the buzz you get from that and the general lifestyle thing, yeah.
So the lifestyles and the epiphanies as well.
Yeah.
What's an area of physics that you struggled to learn about, however?
I'm still rubbish at solid state physics. Please don't ask me anything about that.
all the remaining questions are about solid state physics. Oh no.
Yeah. So I mean, I obviously know the basics and things, but there was a certain point where my brain just stopped allowing things to enter into my head about that stuff. So I can tell you about, you know, semiconductors and conductors and insulators, and I can tell you about bands and band gaps. But there was a certain moment where things just stopped going in.
Okay.
So yeah, I definitely have weaknesses where it comes to certain bits of physics. By then, I was very much deep into astronomy by then. And, you know, that was kind of the majority of my learning at that point.
Okay. And you're doing all right without it just now. So do you have any sports that you participate in or a favorite sport to watch?
Sports. I play golf. Not as much as I'd like. Mostly because my local golf club's too expensive.
You're in the right place for golf if you have a big wallet, yeah.
Well, I mean, I don't live in St Andrews. That's a good point, actually. I live in Ladybank, which is just down the train line from Lucas. And the local golf course there, they do the qualifiers for a lot of the open stuff when it is at St Andrews. So for that reason, it's expensive. So I play golf when I can. I do enjoy table tennis. I don't get to play that much either. But I used to play quite a lot as a kid and really enjoyed that. Basketball was something I did at school as well. I don't do much of that anymore. I used to be the center because I wasn't tall enough. So that was lots of fun. I'd say that's the three sort of sports that I get interested in. I'm not a huge fan of football. I watched the World Cup growing up. I grew up in Perth. And my family was very split down the middle. So my brother was a St. Johnson fan. My parents are from Dundee. So my mum was a Dundee United fan. My dad was a Dundee fan. And so I was kind of in the middle of the war zone here and I couldn't really pick a side. So I just didn't pick one at all. So that probably informed quite a lot about me.
Okay. Have you ever learned any musical instruments?
I tried to learn the violin as a primary school kid and that just didn't go in. I'm not very musical. So I have tried it at turns to learn the guitar and that didn't take either. I enjoy music a lot and my wife is very musical and I think my daughter's going to be very musical as well, but I'm going to be the exception in the family.
Are there any hobbies or activities that you've wanted to try but haven't had the opportunity yet?
Oh, that's
or something that you're envious of other people being able to do?
I mean, music is one. I'd love to be musical. It was just something that I think, frankly, I didn't try hard enough when I was young. And because I didn't try hard enough then, I find it much harder now. I would like to be able to speak more languages. I can speak a bit of German. I did a bit of it at school. And I can understand Italian to some degree. I'm not very good at speaking it. So I would like a bit more of that. Yeah, I can't really think of another one. I think having hobbies as a parent is quite a luxury, right? You spend a lot of time looking after your kids and especially when they're really young and they need all of your time and attention. I would like to do more gardening. I have a garden back at home that I really enjoy being in, but I never get time to be in it. And it kind of suffers as a result. So I'd like to have more time in the garden. But
So you'd like to speak new languages to plants?
Yes. That'd be ideal. There you go, that's one. Okay. Well, one other hobby that I do have that I really enjoy is whiskey. And I get lots of time for that because once my daughter goes to bed, it's much easier to have a drink than it is to do anything else. So I'm a big fan of whiskey. I do go to tastings quite a lot. And we've actually run tastings here in the department for our postgrads, and that's been fun. So there you go. That's one hobby that I'm definitely very proud of.
Well, I was going to ask, if you had to host people for dinner, what would you serve? And what would you have for entertainment?
Oh, there would certainly be drams at the end.
Drams at the end.
Yeah. A good meal always ends with a good dram. That's a really good question.
You were setting the menu.
If I was setting the menu...
Come down with me style.
Come down with me style. In terms of things like my favourite foods, I do love seafood. Scallops and black pudding, I think, is possibly the best starter that you can actually produce.
Okay, that's course one down.
So that's course one down. Main course? I don't know. I'm a bit of a foodie, so I'm finding it kind of hard to choose. I think I would probably go quite traditional and go for like a really good steak. Or, I don't know. It's really hard.
We'll put steak down for
now. We'll put steak down as a
so dessert. You need to round it off before the drums.
Dessert.
You could go for Kraken. That already has whiskey.
I do like raspberries.
But I don't want to make the decision for you.
Yeah, that could be a lot of whiskey. That's a really good question.
This is the question that stumped you the most, this interview.
I know. Like, science is fine. Picking something to eat, however, is really hard. I don't know. That's a really good question. Probably a nice pavlova or... like a nice fruit crumble. We have a nice apple tree in the back garden that's producing loads just now, and I'm looking forward to the first crumbles of the year. So apples and rhubarb crumble is amazing.
Okay.
Yes, there we go.
So scallop, steak,
rhubarb crumble, there you go.
That sounds a fantastic meal. I'll be there. what would you have for the entertainment? You doing party games, or are you showing a movie, or entertainers in?
So we do have some good friends that we play board games with, and... especially after a good meal and a couple of drams, they're absolutely hilarious. So it'd be board games probably, or something like that. Even a game of cards. I used to play poker quite a lot when I was a student back in Edinburgh. I do miss that, actually. That'd be nice to get back into. So all kinds of things. Yeah.
Board games or card games. That sounds great, yeah. I will be. So we're moving on to quickfire rounds, so we can really try and rattle through these. So what's your favourite music genre and favourite song?
I have a couple of favourites. It's not really fair to say that, is it? I grew up listening to Northern Soul. My mum used to play those records all the time. You know, Marvin Gaye, anything by Marvin Gaye, Otis Redding. Who am I listening to at the minute? Billie Holiday, you know, all that kind of stuff. And at the same time, I also quite like, I grew up with indie as well. Like, I was a kid during sort of the Britpop battles. I was very much an Oasis boy.
Soul and indie. And you've soul got a few and indie.
Idlewild is a constant thing on my phone at the minute, I guess. Time to fly. That's kind of a selection of things I listen to.
Okay, what's your favourite book?
My favourite book. There are certain books I read again and again and again. 2001 A Space Odyssey is the reason I'm doing astronomy. Like, my dad bought it for me when I was about 10, and that kind of fired my brain and got me into doing physics. Other books, I tend to read Lord of the Rings about once a year or once every couple of years, although I tend to skip the first few bits because... the songs, the constant songs at the start, you know, that kind of slows me down. And Dune, I think, is probably one of the finest pieces of science fiction ever written. And I go back to that a lot. So there you go, that's a handful.
What's your favourite TV or movie alien? I felt we had to ask.
Oh, right. That's a really good one. I've got a soft spot for Spock. I used to watch the original Star Trek with my dad growing up, and I think it's a really interesting, nuanced character, and it speaks to a lot of things about humans as well, and like controlling the emotional side of yourself, and you know, logic versus emotion, and so I think he's always been a.
So there's a lot in there.
There's a lot in there to unpack.
Okay, well.
Yeah, we'll stick with Spock.
Stick with Spock. Is there anywhere you've always wanted to go or to visit?
I would love to go to Africa, and it's been one of the things on our list, you know, for years. It'll be a while before we get there now with our little girl, but at some point we'll be taking her on safari if we can afford it. That's definitely like a
high on the
list. An ambition of ours. Yeah.
Can you list a few job aspirations you had growing up?
I went through the dinosaur phase that everyone goes through. Jurassic Park came out when I was about 9 or 10.
To be clear, did you want to be a dinosaur or an archaeologist?
I think by then I wanted to be an archaeologist. Yeah, I kind of went through that phase, and I think I was always interested in science. And then it was, I think I was in second year of secondary school, that I had a physics teacher who really kind of turned my head around on physics. He was a substitute teacher, and I never tracked him down afterwards to thank him. But he really turned me around to the idea that physics was really interesting, and that, you know, I was getting into maths at that point, and understanding that maths could be used to say things about the universe was really cool to my brain at that point. So I think it was quite early on that I wanted to do physics of some kind. It wasn't until I started applying for undergrad positions that I realized that astrophysics was the thing I could do. And I was like, well, I've always been interested in space, and you're telling me I can do it as a degree. Brilliant. So I think from quite early on, I wanted to do something that was about looking at the world and how it worked. I was very interested in that.
Okay. What's a snack food that you couldn't live without?
Does coffee count as a snack food?
Sure.
I've always had a very intimate relationship with coffee. And
well, then the next question was going to be, how do you take your coffee, and what's your favourite brand?
It's got to be black. A favourite brand?
Or favourite takeaway?
A favourite takeaway. I mean, it's true that I do take a flat white from various places. I have to say that if I'm going for coffee in St. Andrews, I do try and go to Taste. I think they do the best coffee in town. Although getting in with the queue when the students are here is tough. So that's one good thing about the summer, is that you can go to Taste, you can get a coffee, and it only takes you 5 minutes. It doesn't queue. You don't have to queue for anything.
Until those pesky students get there.
Yeah. The university would be great, wouldn't it? You know, you didn't have students.
So finishing question to round us up. What do you think is the most important thing about humans looking to the stars?
Well, the whole point about humans looking to the universe is that we learn about humans, right? You know, the one sort of key misrepresentation of astrobiology is that it's, you know, it's very high-minded science, and it's about looking away and about looking at other places. And it's not. It's really looking about how we came to be and putting ourselves in cosmic context. And I think when we look at how humans treat each other, and about the things that are bad in the world, I would like to think that one thing astronomy can do is that it can teach us about perspective, and about how limited our time is here and how important it is to be nice to each other. I think of all the things that I can do when I do outreach with kids, that's the one thing I try and hammer home. It's not just the cool things are happening, not about black holes and exploding stars and, you know, alien worlds, is that this world is pretty amazing, right? That's the one thing we keep learning as we keep looking at other worlds, is that we come back to this world and go, wow, how is it that this world managed to keep a relatively stable climate for 4.5 billion years, you know, to the point where we can now have a conversation about it? Like, this is amazing. The fact that we're here and that we get to have this life and we get to look at the universe and we get to understand it and experience the awe of knowing about the universe, understanding how it fits together, the working parts, the bits that physics tells you. That's the thing I think we can take from looking at the stars. That sense of awe and responsibility to each other.
So that's getting perspective on ourselves by looking outwards. Well, thank you very much, Dr. Duncan Forgan. It's been an absolute pleasure. Live long and prosper.
Thank you very much.
If you want to find out more about why our interviewees love science, come and join the Institute of Physics for their Festival of Physics at Dynamic Earth in Edinburgh on the 26th until the 28th of October next month. Find out more on the IOP Scotland Facebook page. You've been listening to Insight, the University of St Andrews Student Physics Society's podcast. I was your host, Samuel Avery. Thanks to the wonderful academics of St Andrews. Join us in the future as we learn more of the people making our education. This podcast was produced by myself and our publicity officer, Connor McBride. To find out more about the Physics Society and what we do, please find us on Facebook or Google St Andrews Physics Society for our website. Goodbye!